Hello friends, welcome to yet another session of KAPP Solutions. I'm your coach Kamaljeet Khurana. The topic which I am going to discuss today is a very important topic called Code of Ethics. When it comes to audit context, Code of Ethics and independence are key to our profession, and these are super important concepts for examination point of view also. So my suggestion before we start the topic is that you have to understand these concepts quite in detail, and then time to time keep practicing the concept related to independence. When it comes to examination, the independence and code of ethics are hardly tested theoretically. The way basically they ask these kind of questions is they not only want you to understand what is the threat to independence, but they also want you to understand what is the significance of that threat. Not every single threat to independence is something where auditor need to take an action or management needs to take an action. However, if the significance of that threat is too much and it does hamper the audit judgment, in that case certainly we need to take an action on. So in this particular topic, how I would recommend you guys to study, just focus one. Step number one is to how the threat arises to independence. So we need to identify the threat to independence. In step number two, we really need to understand how material the threat is. And of course, step number three is to mitigate that risk, whether to eliminate that risk or maybe reduce that risk to the tolerable limit. So that should be the core for this particular concept. As I said before, this topic needs to be understood very clearly and very nicely, because from examination point of view, it does has lot of importance. To begin with, let's start with the code of ethics and conduct. Every profession has certain code of ethics or code of conduct to follow. And in this profession also, in audit, we definitely need to follow certain code of ethics and conduct. So before we move to as to what are our code of ethics, let's understand two important theory. We call them rule-based theory and principle-based theory. So let me give you a basic example and explain how rule-based theory works. Rule-based theory is a theory where certain things you have to follow just like that. And if you won't follow it, there is a punishment for not doing it. For example, in your city, you have to really wear the helmet or a seat belt. If you won't wear it, there is a punishment behind it. Now, this is rule-based theory. A rule-based theory is a theory which generally are not customized to the country's need, but you have to adopt it just like that only. And if you do not follow that, there may be harsh punishment for not doing it. So the example of rule-based theory could be SOX. SOX compliance is not a choice for company. Any company which is listed with United States Stock Exchange, they have to follow SOX. When it comes to SOX, the compliance is mandatory. Management has to follow SOX no matter what. If they will not follow SOX, the company will be delisted from the stock exchange and the senior management can be punished. They do not get bonus till the time the company is non-SOX compliant. Now that's what we call rule-based theory. You have to really follow it. In rule-based theory, as we discussed, there is no scope of customization. So one size fits all. This is how rule-based theory can be put in. Now, if we talk about principle-based theory, the principle-based theory says you should follow this, and if you won't follow it, there has to be strong justification why are you not following it. But there may not be such a harsh punishment like a rule-based theory if you would not follow principle-based theory. The principle-based theory can be customized basis the country's need. So that is what we call principle-based theory. So for example, SOX is an example of rule-based theory, whereas the principle-based theory's example could be all conceptual frameworks, which may include your code of ethics also. I'm not saying that code of ethics is not mandatory to follow. Yes, it is. but it definitely needs certain customization as per company, as per industry, as per country. So that is the core difference between rule-based theory and principle-based theory. Now, once we understand the basic difference of rule-based theory and principle-based theory, let's understand the next concept called code of ethics. Every profession has to have certain principles to follow, so that there has to be a standard to follow in the profession and the user can have more confidence in that profession. And when this profession comes to as an audit, auditor's opinion matters a lot. When auditors say the financial statements are free from any misstatement, users believe it. Users feel confident to take decision on the basis of assurance of an auditor. And that is where auditor needs to be really, really particular about their code of ethics. So now let's understand the fundamental principles, what we call code of ethics. The first, what we call, is integrity. The integrity means honesty. So a professional has to follow, the professional has to be honest in all his or her deed. You cannot use your own judgments and assumption, but you have to be really honest when it comes to work. So that's what we call integrity. The next is objectivity. Objectivity means unbiased approach. If I ask you, what is this? The answer will be, yes, this is a pen. But if I ask you, is this black pen is beautiful? Now my next question was a subjective question. The first question was an objective question, which was a fact-based question as to what is this. All of us can see this is a pen. However, when I ask the second question, is this black pen beautiful? It's a subjective question. Many users may have a different opinions on that. And that is where, when you are subjective, you use your imagination, assumptions. Being an auditor, you are supposed to be objective, not subjective. When you are objective, you see the fact the way it is. And that's a fact-based, unbiased approach. So being an auditor, you have to have objectivity. The third says professional competence and due care. There are two elements of it. Professional competence. A person should have required knowledge, skill set to handle the assignment. You should never take an assignment where you are not having enough skills and experience to handle that. And when we say due care, there's nothing called I did not know in this audit profession. There is no scope of negligence in this profession. So you have to be very, very clear and you have to be having lot of care when you do this assignment. That's what we call due care. There are two elements of it, professional competence and due care. The next is called confidentiality. Goes without saying, the nature of our profession is that we do deal in lot of sensitive and confidential information. What if an auditor goes out and discloses all these details to a third party? It can be really, really problematic for the client. And that's where we have to follow the confidentiality whenever we work on any assignment. And it is not just that when you are working on a certain assignment, you have to follow confidentiality. The confidentiality needs to be followed afterwards also. Even if you have done this assignment, say 10 years back, the code of ethics still says that please maintain the confidentiality. But of course, there can be a lot of exception to this rule of confidentiality. For example, if you get a court's notice that you have to disclose certain information of the client, in that case, the legal order might prevail over the code of ethics. So code of ethics confidentiality never says that you have to hide everything about client, even if your client is doing illegal activity like money laundering. All it is trying to say that you have to maintain the confidentiality of the client. And then comes professional behavior. It is very easy to say professional behavior, that a person has to be professional in all his or her capacity in the dealings. But it is slightly tough to follow in the life. Now let me give you an example the same kind of question was being tested in examination before. So let me give you a scenario that you are a professional, let's say an auditor. Let's say you are ACCA. In that case, after working hours, you went to a pub with your friends. You had certain drinks and then you came out of the pub and you started dancing on the road. Of course, it's night, you're not working, it's your personal time, and you started dancing. And of course, there was a loud music. With the noise of music, some neighbor complained to the police and police came. Now my question is, are you violating the professional behavior code of ethics? Is your answer yes or no? So the answer is yes. Lot of you may argue that what profession has to do with this? It was your own personal time. You can do whatever you want. Yes, you can. Then certainly do that. Now imagine the next day's newspaper setting. A ACCA candidate was found doing this nuisance on main road. What is at stake? The profession? What is at stake is the body which you belong to. Now that's where professional behavior is required from all the professionals when it comes to your dealing with the public or in a public place. So these are some important professional code of ethics: integrity, objectivity, professional competence and due care, confidentiality, and professional behavior. I'm sure by now we have understood the basic of code of ethics. And now it is time for us to move to the next important segment, the independence and threat to independence. Once we have understood the basic code of ethics, it is time for us to understand a quite an important concept called independence. Let's see what independence means for an auditor. If we talk about the auditing standard, attribute standard 1100 defines independence as freedom from the conditions that threaten the ability to carry out the audit in unbiased manner. Goes without saying, and as we discussed in the code of ethics also, being an auditor needs to be fact-based, unbiased. There can be lot of conditions inside and outside an organization which may impact the auditor's independence. And when their auditor's independence get threatened, they go biased. Since the assurance of auditor is pretty important for a user, it is very, very important that auditor gives an unbiased assurance. And that is where the independence is quite an important element for an auditor. If you talk about corporate governance has its own mechanism to maintain the independence of auditor. So if you know about CG, we know that there are two types of reporting which exist in corporate governance: the administrative reporting and functional reporting. These reporting standards are actually an example of preserving the independence of an auditor. So that is how independence can be defined. If we talk about objectivity, as we discussed a couple of minutes back, objectivity means unbiased. So when we say independence and objectivity for an auditor, there is not somebody who's going to bind the auditor physically. It's more about mental independence. Are auditors free to take a decision or not? Now that is quite an important element, and that is where objectivity of an auditor comes into picture. So we call that unbiased mental attitude. That is how objectivity can be defined. Now, once we know the meaning of objectivity and independence, let's see how do we go about the threats to independence. Anything which impacts the auditor's independence and objectivity could be considered as a threat. And let's bifurcate those threats into various areas. The first is self-interest. Self-interest is something where auditor's personal interest is involved. There can be various examples where auditor's personal interest can be involved in client's business. For example, an auditor has purchased shares of that particular company. Could be a self-interest. A fee dependency could be a self-interest. So we shall be discussing this element in detail. We call them self-interest threat. Now, how to approach an examination question if you have to identify whether it is a self-interest threat or not. Whenever you see any personal interest of auditor is involved in this, we may classify clearly them as a self-interest threat. Also, it is not always necessary that a particular threat will be clearly categorized into one category only. There may be a lot of examples where there can be self-interest threat as well as advocacy threat. So we should be able to identify them properly as to what kind of category this risk falls into. We talk about examination point of view and the marking system. They definitely give separate marking as to are you able to clearly identify that or not. So that's called self-interest threat, where auditor's personal benefits are involved in that client's business. The next is called advocacy. Advocacy threat is a threat where auditors favor the client. When I say favor the client, maybe they are representing the client in certain matters, let's say taxation matter or any other matter, or in certain negotiation, auditors are involved. We can call them advocacy threat. Intimidation threat, where auditors feel threatened from the client, we call them intimidation threat. Whenever you find any signal in the question which talks about the threat, which could be intimidation threat for an auditor. Familiarity threat. When auditor knows the client too well, there is a familiarity threat comes into picture. So that is the prime reason that auditors' rotations are involved. Ideally, auditors should take an assignment in rotations. Now, familiarity threat is a threat where they become too pally, too friendly to each other, and that is where auditors are unable to find the weaknesses in the control of the client. And then comes the self-review threat. It's a human tendency that you just cannot find your own fault. An auditor is no exception. So self-review threat comes into picture when you have to check your own work. It may arise when you are involved in setting the controls for the business, or you are the one who is doing tax planning for the client. When you are doing this work, you just cannot find the fault in it. And that is where self-review threat arises. In self-review, auditors cannot get into maker and checker mode because they were the one who were maker, and when it comes to become a checker for them, it becomes a challenge. So primarily we can classify the threat into these 4-5 major categories: self-interest, self-review, familiarity, advocacy and intimidation. So the first thing which we should know about these kind of questions is first how to identify the threat. And in every threat, there may be certain subcategories. For example, in self-interest, there could be fee dependency, shares in the client, and so on. So when it comes to identify the risk, you don't need to just highlight the major category, say self-interest. You have to be precisely telling whether it's a self-interest plus fee dependency or what. Now that is what we call identification of threat. If we talk about practical point of view, why this identification is required, unless and until an auditor will be able to identify the threat, how will he mitigate? So that is why it is quite an important thing that auditor should be able to identify the threats. So this is how we're gonna discuss the threats. Now let's discuss each and every threat quite in detail. It is not sufficient for us to just identify the threat, but we should also know the safeguards around it. So the first threat is self-interest threat. As we discussed, any threat where the personal interest of audit partner or the auditor is involved, we call that self-interest threat. Mostly these self-interest threat may involve certain kind of financial angles. So the first thing is called own shares. Own share is something where the auditor owns the share in that client's business. Whenever you are an investor in a company, you always want that company to grow. Because when the company will grow, your share will grow. Whenever the auditors are involved and they are invested in the client's business, their independence get hampered because they own shares in the company. How to safeguard it? The safeguard around it, that auditors should never hold any share in the client's business. If they already have shares of that client, the moment they take an audit, they have to sell their share. And this is not just for this auditor, but their immediate family members also. So if an auditor or their family members have shares in the company, they have to sell those shares. And those auditors should generally be not involved in the audit of the client. So if you have an audit team, nobody in the audit team should hold any share in the client's business. That is what we call own share. So how to approach the question? First, identify that under self-interest threat, it is own shares or financial gain kind of heading. And then we should know the safeguard around it. If I talk about significance of this, it does not matter how many shares you own. So as we discussed in the beginning, that with every threat, we have to identify their impact also. Even if you hold one share in the business, it is considered to be material. So here there is no materiality concept as such applicable when it comes to own the shares. The second threat is called fee dependency. May possible that your client is a big company and being an audit firm, you may not have many clients. So basically, largely you are dependent on a client's business. If the client will go, if it is annoyed with you, then probably it impacts your fee quite a lot. That is called fee dependency. So there can be two classifications for fee dependency case, the listed and non-listed. If the question says the client is non-listed company, in that case, fee dependency question needs to be handled in this way. If an audit firm is largely dependent on particular client for the fee, in that case, the company should reduce that dependency. They should try to have more clients in place, and in certain cases, they can get their independent quality review. In certain matter, they can take third party opinion also. So that is what about non-listed company. Here, the quantum of fees is not defined. It can be a large sum of your total revenue. When it comes to the listed client, if it is more than 15% of firm's total revenue in the last two consecutive years, in that case, it is considered to be fees dependency. Repeat, if your audit firm is entirely dependent on a particular client and the fees which comes from this client is more than 15% of total revenue in the last two consecutive years, that's where a threat to independence arises. So this is threat and this is material. How to safeguard it? One, that we should reduce that dependency on the client. Second, we have to report to those charged with governance if it is more than 15%. Third, you need to get your independent quality review by a third party so that there should not be any biasness in the decision making. So this is about fees and dependency. The next comes gifts and hospitality. It is very common for auditors that they go to do audit at certain places and the client gives them certain gifts. Not every gift can be threat to independence, but as a normal practice, auditors should avoid taking any gifts and hospitality because they feel obliged after taking the gift. So there can be a lot of thumb rules in terms of gifts and hospitality. For example, if the gifts are of too petty an amount, for example, the local delicacies been given to the auditor, or some kind of chocolates and sweets have been given, probably it may not be considered as a threat to independence. But the monetary value of the gift and the nature of gift also defines quite a lot. So one thing what you should know here is how big or small that gift is. Second, how it may impact the decision of an auditor. That is how gifts and hospitalities will be taken care. As a normal practice, auditor should avoid taking any gifts and hospitality from the client, because sooner or later, larger or smaller, it does impact the auditor's independence. Then comes business and personal relationships. So if the auditor has any kind of business and personal relationship with the client, that may become a threat to independence. For example, auditor has a joint venture with the client. They have certain kind of marketing arrangements. They have some kind of dealing of purchase of goods and services. All these could be considered as business and personal relationship. Though not every purchase of goods and services may be considered as a threat, so here the materiality and the amount and the frequency can be considered as an important element. How to safeguard that? One, that auditor should never have any kind of business and personal relationship with the client. If any particular auditor in the audit team has a relationship, that auditor should be removed from the audit team for this client. If the goods and services purchase is of material amount, in that case, this auditor needs to be removed from the audit team. This is how we can safeguard business and personal relationship. Employment with the client. Goes without saying that any future promise by client to offer a job to the auditor can impact the independence of an auditor. So if auditor has any kind of employment, current or future, that particular auditor should be removed from the audit team, because it may definitely impact the independence of an auditor. Litigation with the client. So litigation with the client, where there could be some kind of threat by client to sue the auditor, or there is already some pending litigation, it may impact the independence of an auditor. The first problem arises that relationship of client and auditor gets spoiled. So one, that auditor may not be impartial. Second, client may be reluctant to provide any information to the auditor. So that is how it may impact the independence of an auditor. The safeguard could be, if the litigation is against certain individual, that individual should be removed from the audit team. If it is against the firm, it should be discussed with the audit committee, and if required, there can be an independent quality review of the audit work. So this is how litigation with the client should be dealt with. Then comes contingent fees. Contingent fees means a fee which is dependent on any future future act or future incident. For example, if the company will get this much profit, auditor's fees will be this. Now that's called contingent fee. As per code of ethics, contingent fees is not allowed for an auditor. Auditor can never charge a fee which is dependent on the future act or a future incidents or future outcomes. So that is where these kind of risk needs to be considered when it comes to self-interest head. Once again, I suggest when you have to deal with these kind of questions, first understand the threat, understand their impact, and then see as to how we're gonna safeguard that. So that was about first threat called self-interest threat. Now let's discuss the second kind of threat called intimidation threat. As the name suggests, anything which threatens the auditor called intimidation threat. The first way how an auditor can feel threatened could be fee dependency. For example, your fees is pending from the client, and then you feel threatened that if you give any negative report, the client may never give you your fee. Now that can be intimidation threat. A personal relationship. Suppose you have some kind of relationship with the top management, personal, they are your friends or relatives. In that case, that may become an intimidation threat. audit partner leaves the firm to join the client and they feel intimidated that if they give any negative report, the client will never take them for job. And that is where we call them audit partner leaves the firm to join the client. And then comes litigation with the client. If there is already any pending litigation with the client, that may become a threat for the auditor to give an unbiased opinion. So these kind of threats are called intimidation threat. Now let's move to the next category and discuss called self-review threat. As we discussed, it is very difficult to check your own work. Self-review threat arises when the auditors themselves are involved in the work of clients and then they are the one who are doing audit for them. That is where self-review threat arises. The first is accounts preparation. So in accounts preparation, again, there can be two scenarios, listed and non-listed. If it is non-listed client, the audit firm can provide the accounting and related services to the client. However, the team should be separate. So the team which has made accounts for this particular client should not be the one who is doing audit. If it is a listed entity, then it is clear no. You just cannot provide accounting services to the client where you are going to do audit. So in examination, please look at it clearly whether we are talking about listed entity or we are talking about non-listed entity. Then comes internal audit task. Whether an auditor can provide internal audit or not to the client where you are giving the external audit. So in case you are the one who are setting internal control for this client, you just cannot do internal audit for this client. It is clear no that if you have set internal control, you will never be doing internal audit for that. If it is a big audit firm, in that case, maybe a separate team can be used to do the internal audit. Taxation work. Generally, an auditors are not supposed to provide a tax planning for this client. If it is related to some minor taxation issues, the auditor can advise them. But if the auditors are involved in the tax planning for the client, they cannot do the audit for that. So that is where taxation work should not be provided to the client. Any kind of valuation services. So in valuation services, you have to really see again non-listed and listed. If it is a non-listed entity, your client is non-listed, then you have to see how significant that valuation services are. If this valuation has a larger and significant material impact on financial statement, it cannot be provided. So is for the listed entity. Any kind of valuation which can impact the financial statement materially will never be provided for the auditor. But if it is a non-listed entity and the valuation services are not of that big a significance on financial statement, it can be provided by a separate team. So that is how we can deal with listed and non-listed entity. Client staff joins the audit firm. If somebody who used to work with audit firm now has left and joined the client, then again we have to see this carefully. So for example, if a partner level person from the audit firm has left and joined the client, in that case, there can be lot of threats arise. Self-interest threat, self-review threat, familiarity threat. That should never be allowed. So an audit partner level person cannot be allowed to join a client. Secondly, if somebody at the client's place, who is at the director or top management level, again, if they know anybody in the audit firm because they used to work there, then can be again similar kind of threat, which may be a self-review threat, self-interest threat, familiarity threat, and that is where it should not be allowed when the client staff joins the audit firm or vice versa. So all these are covered under self-review threat, where auditors are reviewing their own task. Now let's discuss another threat called familiarity threat. Familiarity threat is a threat when the client and auditor knows each other too well. Generally, this problem arises when auditors do audit for very long time with the same client, where the management is also same. Then familiarity threat arises because both gets too comfortable with each other. And since auditor gets too comfortable and then they know them too well, they are not able to pinpoint the mistakes. Then their independence gets hampered. That is where familiarity threat arises. The first is long association. Let's classify again into non-listed and listed. If the client is non-listed, then the senior audit partner should be rotated. A person should not be going for audit to the client for a very long time. This is for a non-listed client. If it is a listed client, then there are strict clauses behind it. Not more than 7 years. A senior audit partner should not be going for audit for more than 7 years in a row. If a certain audit partners have been going for audit with the client for more than 7 years, then they have to take a break of minimum 2 years before they restart with the client. This particular 2 years cooling period is given so that some other auditor can come and cross check. So that is how for a listed company, if the client is too large a listed entity, after 10 years, a particular audit firm will be removed from the tendering itself. So after 10 years, for the 10 year in a row, if an audit firm has done audit for the client, then they will not be considered for the tendering again. That is for very large entities. So this is what we call long association. The problem with the long association may arise when the management remains same. There is no structural change in the business. There is no change in the line of the business. Then everything remains too familiar to the auditor. And that is where the independence gets threatened. The personal relationships. Goes without saying, if the client and auditor know each other too well, the personal relationship could be there and familiarity threat arises. So when familiarity, the personal relationships are there, those people should not be chosen for audit for that particular client. Movement of staff between the firm and the client. This is called advocacy threat. Advocacy threat arises when the auditor or audit firm represents the client somewhere. Since they are representing the client, their independence gets threatened. So the first example could be representing the client in tax matter or any other legal matter when they are going on behalf of the client and representing the client. So ideally that is prohibited, that should not be done by the audit firm. Promoting the client by any manner through for share investing or for any other purpose, if the audit firm is promoting the client, that should not be allowed. And negotiation on behalf of the client. For example, the client is actually going for some kind of big deal and auditors are helping in the negotiation process. Those kind of things should not be allowed because it does impact the independence of auditor. So these could be certain example of advocacy threat. By now, we have discussed quite a lot of threats, their safeguards, their impact. Now, we have to really see as to how to deal with it. Those kind of questions, how do we deal with those questions? First, you should be able to identify the threat clearly, whether it comes under self-review, self-interest, and so on. Under self-review also, what kind of category of risk we are having. So that is the first step. Then we assess. When I say we assess the risk, that means we are basically trying to know the impact of that risk, whether it is material or not material. Then we apply the safeguard. The safeguard can be two types. Either we eliminate the risk or we reduce it to the acceptable level. There could be certain risk which cannot be reduced to an acceptable level. For example, when auditor holds shares in the client business. Now those kind of risks just cannot be reduced to any acceptable risk. In that case, we have no option but to eliminate. So that should be the strategy to deal with this question. Whether it is an MCQ paper or it's a subjective paper, the concept and the way to deal with it remains same. That is how I would recommend this particular topic needs to be studied. Now, if we talk about the, again, examination point of view, these days the question does not give you marks for just identifying the threat. They also want you to understand the impact of it, how material it is, what is the impact of those kind of things on the financial statement. Because if we talk about practical point of view also, just by evaluating the threat would not be sufficient. It is very important that we understand how it impacts the financial statements also. So that is where overall shift is happening when it comes to weightage and examination. And that is where again and again I'm repeating, just try to understand the threat and their impact as much as you can. So that is broadly all about this topic, which is called code of ethics and independence. When it comes to independence and objectivity, we should be able to handle those kind of questions quite in detail, and for all examination purpose, I would rate this topic quite a lot because it's quite an important topic. So that's all about this particular chapter. I'm your coach Kamaljeet. Once again, thank you so much for attending my session. These are our contact details in case you want to get in touch, and I wish you all the very best for your examination. Thank you so much. Let's meet up once again. Till then, stay tuned. Thank you so much.